Hey guys, here's me continuing to read some parts of Solomon Northup's 12 Years a Slave and just giving my kind of general commentary, maybe worthless or not that worthwhile comments as I kind of just talk about this book. But anyway, let me continue. So this is chapter 5. We're now at chapter 5 and Solomon Northup meets this guy named Arthur who is a slave. So he's now working. Solomon Northup is now assigned to this plantation. He's been bought and sold to this plantation, and he meets a slave, Arthur. And I think I just like his description of Arthur. So this is what he says. But the most prominent of the four was a man named Arthur. As the lighter approached, he struggled stoutly with his keepers. It was with main force that he was dragged aboard the brig. He protested in a loud voice against the treatment he was receiving and demanded to be released. His face was swollen and covered with wounds and bruises, and indeed, one side of it was a complete row of sores. So pause, hold on a sec. Actually, he's not sold to the plantation yet. He's still in the brig. He's still in the process of being sold. Sorry. I jumped on the gun there. Anyway, I'm going to continue. Arthur was forced with all haste down the hatchway into the hold. I caught an outline of the story as he was borne struggling along, of which he afterwards gave me a more full relation, and it was as follows. He had long resided in the city of Norfolk, and was a free man. He had a family living there, and was a mason by trade. Having been unusually detained, he was returning late one night to his house in the suburbs of the city, when he was attacked by a gang of persons in an unfrequented street. He fought until his strength failed him. Overpowered at last, he was gagged and bound with ropes and beaten until he became insensible. For several days, they secreted him in the slave pen at Norfolk. A very common establishment appears in the cities of the South. The night before, he had been taken out and put on board the lighter, which, pushing out from shore, had awaited our arrival. For some time, he continued his protestations, and altogether was irreconcilable. At length, however, he became silent. He sank into a gloomy and thoughtful mood, and appeared to be counseling with himself. There was in the man's determined face something that suggested the thought of desperation. So, Arthur is a guy who was a free man, like Solomon Northup. But in the amount of time that Arthur was free to the time he meets Solomon, he's broken. Like, this is a guy who fought with such desperation against these people who captured him, and then in the end, he's just this desperate, broken guy who's given up. And that's kind of the power of these captors, what they're able to do to dehumanize these people, to capture them, to make them give up the fight that they have in them. It's a pretty amazing system that was in place at the time. Slavery is often referred to as a very peculiar institution, and yeah, it certainly is. Now it gets kind of talking more about slaves. So this is a quote I'll read. The slaves were fed twice a day, at 10 and 5 o'clock, always receiving the same kind and quantity of fare, and in the same manner as above described. At night, we were driven into the hold and securely fastened down. So that's how they sleep. They're like sleeping fastened down to a blanket that is more appropriate for a horse, which is an awful way to spend one's night for sure. And they're in a boat, by the way. The seasickness rendered the place of our confinement loathsome and disgusting. It would have been a happy thing for most of us. It would have saved us the agony of many hundred lashes and miserable death at last, had the compassionate sea snatched us that day from the clutches of remorseless men. The thought of Randall and little Emmy sinking down among the monsters of the deep is a more pleasant contemplation than to think of them as they are now, perhaps dragging our lives up unrecorded toil. So there's almost like a suicidal fantasy going on here. It would be better if all of us was just killed off by the ocean than to have to go through our lives as slaves. And that's something he like fantasizes here in saying that, you know, these little kids, Emmy and Randall, maybe they would have been better off dead than to have gone through all this and have become slaves as they are now. Quote, I thank God who has since permitted me to escape from the thraldom of slavery, that through his merciful interposition, I was prevented from imbuing my hands in the blood of his creatures. Let not those who have never been placed in like circumstances judge me harshly. until they have been chained and beaten, until they find themselves in the situation I was, borne away from home and family towards a land of bondage. Let them refrain from saying that they would not what they would not do for liberty. How far I should have been justified in the sight of God and man, it is unnecessary now to speculate upon. It is enough to say that I'm able to congratulate myself upon the harmless termination of an affair which threatened, for a time, to be attended with serious results. Powerful. Solomon Northup writes in such a way that's just like, I don't know, so moving. I don't think I do his writing much justice by reading them aloud like this. But I do loving parts. I do love reading this thing, just being so touched by it in a way. And yeah, being able to read parts of it like that. Another part that I want to read. There was not another slave we dared to trust. Brought up in fear and ignorance as they are, it can scarcely be conceived how servilely they will cringe before a white man's look. So, there's no one to trust. Not even other slaves, because they live in fear of their white masters. So, they might tell another slave, their master, of something. You know, there's no one to trust. They're in this desperate situation. And I kind of highlighted some moments, you know, where Solomon Northup talks about God in this. Because you can see he's a very faithful, religious person, even going through after all this. And, you know, by the time of this writing, he's still a very religious, faith-driven person. So I thought that was a very interesting thing to note. Here we go. Another quote, page 90. We were all panic-stricken by the appearance of the smallpox. So smallpox happens. The captain ordered lime to be scattered through the hold, and other prudent precautions to be taken. The death of Robert, however, and the presence of the malady oppressed me sadly, and I gazed out over the great waste of waters with a spirit that was indeed disconsolate. And the vocabulary he uses in this is amazing. The amount of learning that the Solomon Northup has is quite remarkable. When I was reading this, sometimes I had to look up some, and I had to go, you know, into the dictionary and look up the word because I had no idea what the meaning was. You know, very elaborate usage of language. My good friend, whose name was John Manning, was an Englishman by birth and a noble-hearted, generous sailor as ever walked the deck. Why did I highlight that? He lived in Boston. I don't know who John Manning is. Anyway, next scene. Next quote. A happy and touching scene was witnessed immediately upon our reaching the levee. Just as Manning left the brig on his way to the post office, two men came up and called aloud for Arthur. The latter, as he recognized them, was almost crazy with delight. He could hardly be restrained from leaping over the brig's side, and when they met soon after, he grasped them by the hand and clung to them a long, long time. They were men from Norfolk who had come on to New Orleans to rescue him. His kidnappers, they informed him, had been arrested, and were then confined in a Norfolk prison. They conversed a few moments with the captain, and then departed with the rejoicing Arthur. So, Arthur gets his freedom. Soon, Arthur would rejoin his family, and have the satisfaction of seeing his wrongs avenged. My family, alas, should I ever see them more? There was a feeling of utter desolation in my heart, filling it with a despairing and regretful sense that I had not gone down with Robert to the bottom of the sea. So Arthur gets his freedom this way, but unfortunately for Solomon Northup, his slavery continues. Next quote. Oh yeah, this is the part where this is a very interesting part. So I'll end the video with just this scene. Captain, where's Platt? Demanded Theophilus Freeman. The captain was unable to inform him, no one being on board answering to that name. Who shipped that nigger? He again inquired the captain, pointing to me. Birch, replied the captain. Your name is Platt. You answer my description. Why don't you come forward? He demanded of me in an angry tone. I informed him that was not my name, that I had never been called by it, but that I had no objection as to it as I knew of. Well, I will learn you your name, said he, and so you won't forget it either. Bye, he added. So, Solomon Northup, that's his name, but Just for no reason whatsoever, this guy, this captain, whatever, says your name is now Platt, and that's what I'm gonna teach go by, and that's the name you're going to learn from me. That's your name now. So, Solomon Roar just gets the name Platt, and that name sticks with him throughout the story. And that actually becomes a huge problem, as you'll see in the very ending parts of the book. But yeah, it's just a very interesting scene. Like, how does that happen? How does someone just go be like, you know, hey, I'm looking for Platt. Who the hell is that? No one here is by the name. Oh, you're Platt. No, I never, that's not my name. I've never been called that name. Psh, look, you know who you're talking to? I'm going to teach you your name. Your name is Platt. That's it. And that's final. That's what happens. Pretty remarkable. Not remarkable in a good way, but just like, what the fuck kind of way, right? Anyway, that's my video. I will continue this book. It's very, very powerful stuff. Cheers.